Hello and welcome to Politics Today. I'm Farooq Patafi. Once again, we are going to talk about political situation in the country, especially Maulana Fazlur Rahman's threat of marching on Islamabad. It is important because while we keep on underestimating the religious politics of the country, it has the capacity to surprise us. We haven't seen much focus by the media on the matter in the last 24 hours, perhaps because the royal family of Great Britain is in Pakistan and the media is focusing more on that. But Maulana's plan to march on Islamabad continues unabated. Additionally, he made a very interesting observation. He said that the government ministers are trying to provoke his marchers. Which marchers? No marchers have started off for Islamabad yet. So what is he talking about? And what exactly is going to be the government strategy? We tried to actually take stock of that yesterday. We are going to talk about that today as well. And the second aspect, which is very important, is while we keep on looking at Maulana Fazlur Rahman's politics and the government's response, we kind of don't focus that much on the other opposition parties. There are three major parties which are important here. The first one, of course, is PMLN. It seems that there is a division upon division within the ranks, ranks and files of PMLN. Then People's Party, which has already declared itself retired herd, which is going to lend moral support, whatever that means. It is not going to participate in the marching. And the third is Jamaat-e-Islami, which used to be a close ally of JUIF. It seems that it is focusing more on Kashmir policy rather than Maulana's own agenda. And what exactly is Maulana's agenda? We don't know. We will try to find that out in this program as well. In order to help us understand these issues, we are joined by Barrister Danish Iftikhar, who is a legal expert. Thank you very much, sir, for being part of the program. Next to him is Naseem Siddiqui, sir, who is a political analyst slash journalist. Thank you very much, sir, for being part of the program. And next to him is Javed Rana, another senior journalist. Thank you very much, sir, for being part of the program. Barrister sir, with your permission, I'm going to first go to the political side, and let me ask Javed Rana sahab on the status of Maulana Fazlur Rahman's march on Islamabad. It continues unabated, sir?
I think this very schedule and the very dates of the Maulana's march is very important.
Okay.
First, by mistake or maybe out of sheer ignorance, he decided 27th, a date when the Srinagar was occupied by the Indian forces. Mm-hmm. After it was pointed out by foreign minister, then he changed the schedule. And now is 31st October.
Okay.
You may recall that every year, for years we've been seeing this, from 31st October to next 2 weeks, which means by 14 November, these are the days when Tablighi Jamaat, hundreds of thousands of people, they actually go to Lahore, Raivind, to participate in these religious gatherings. Mm-hmm. And people gather in Lahore, Raivind, every year during these two weeks. Mm-hmm. Now everybody who's with a grown-up beard, mostly, usually they participate, but not necessarily. Now on that very date, Maulana Sahab is going to march on to Islamabad. Mm-hmm. So the point is, those who are going to participate purely in a religious gathering, mm-hmm. They could possibly be mistakenly treated by the security forces as the one who are going to march on Islamabad.
How do you figure that out? Because, you know, Raivind is in Punjab, and most of the activities actually focus or momentum is within Punjab. And you're talking about Maulana Fazlur Rahman, who's going to come from Khyber Pakhtunkhwa.
Khyber Pakhtunkhwa's Chief Minister Mahmood Khan has already made it public that they are going to block this march. That means there is going to be possibility of a showdown between security forces and marchers.
Where? In DI Khan?
In
Peshawar?
In KPK. Okay. I mean, they have the pockets of their supporters in these areas.
Okay.
Now, from these areas and also from elsewhere in the country,
okay,
people are going to move towards Lahore to participate in religious gathering.
Okay.
How the security forces will make distinction?
Okay, you're not helping us and point, find a solution. You're helping us see the problem. The solution,
I think, to begin with, the government must negotiate with Maulana Saab.
Okay.
So he needs to change the date, mm-hmm. number one. The second option is, I think the government can make a request to Tablighi Jamaat if they could possibly change the date. It is easier said than done because...
The latter is more difficult because there is huge number that attends that
number.
Congregation. But since he has actually brought out the issue of... Siddiqui Saab, he has actually brought out the issue of religion. So I'm not going to hint at another thing that the day is also popular for something else. Halloween, actually. So I thought at that time that Maulana is actually going to give the government or try to give the government a scare, dressed in something interesting. But what exactly do you think is going to happen?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, thank you for inviting. First of all, I don't think so that Maulana would be coming for a dharna in Islamabad. He okay. won't be allowed, or he may change his program.
Not allowed by whom?
Not allowed by the court. As well, because okay. there is case in the court as well. Okay. So if court abandons him, then he won't be coming to Islamabad.
Right.
And two parties.
Yeah, he keeps on mentioning the constitution of Pakistan. But so he rather should abide by it as well.
That's my finding that he won't be allowed to come to Dharna. Okay. But he will be doing that Azadi march in different cities, okay. in which Pakistan Muslim League Noon is going to support mm-hmm. him and People's Party as well.
I'm going to talk about PMLN in a bit.
Yeah,
but
okay.
I want to understand what exactly are Maulana's motivations. What motivated him to actually come to Islamabad
actually,
or declare it?
Actually, when it was Imran Khan's dharna, so he criticized a lot Maulana Saab for the dharna.
Yeah.
And that dharna was against the corrupt people and corruption.
Okay.
But why Maulana is coming here? Nobody knows
are his stated objectives apart from bringing down the government? There must be some, right?
Yeah, he just wants to bring down the government, nothing else.
Why?
Because he wants to come into the National Assembly, he wants to come into the government, he will ask for the re-elections.
Even if I set out to bring down a government, I'm not going to say, look, I'm part out of the parliament, so I have to bring down the government, right?
Yeah, but
I have to create some kind of facade, some excuse to bring down the government.
Yeah.
So what exactly is he's
saying that they have solved the Kashmir matter in UN Assembly and to America, and they're creating the issue like it's...
Advocacy is selling, right?
Yeah, that's he's trying to selling, but nobody is going to buy whatever he is selling at the moment.
Now, let me come to Barrister Saab. Barrister Saab, your take on the entire matter. There are two concerns that I have. Repeatedly, Islamabad has been held hostage by people who came here and staged dharnas, right? Initially, it was political, but later on, it took a religious character also. TLP was an example. Repeatedly, the local administration was found lacking, and then legal system could not offer that kind of solutions either. Right? We have seen reports, we have seen judgment even from a former judge. But what exactly is the status now? If somebody wants to just come to Islamabad and take over, they can?
Well, first of all, I think that as a political party or as an entity, organization, mm-hmm. or anyone else as an individual, you have the right to express yourself.
Right.
You have the right to dissent. You have the right of a different of opinion. And you have a certain way of expressing that and, you know, expressing your emotions and expressing your, you know, whatever you're protesting against.
And but right of assembly is a part of it.
Right of assembly is a part of there. And the courts have in the past and even now, they've facilitated all these kinds of attempts because this is a process of democracy itself.
Right.
If you don't allow people to express themselves, it will be a negation of the whole concept of democracy.
Yeah.
But
expressing is one thing.
Yeah.
Disrupting my life and your life becomes a problem. Well, and then we are sitting on a powder keg. This country has seen a lot of religiously motivated terrorism, A. Secondly, we are talking about federal capital that houses the diplomatic community, the constitutional and legal bodies as well. So does it not create a problem if someone who is carrying batons threatens to actually come and disrupt life in Islamabad?
Well, that is where I think he's being a bit diplomatic as well. Okay. Because he hasn't, as of yet, he hasn't declared that there will be a sit-in. That card he has kept very close to his heart. You know, he has announced that there would be a rally, there will be a long march, but he has said that in conjunction with the advice that he has received from even PMLN, they have said that the strategy of whether it would be a dharna or not, whether it would be a sit-in or not, would be decided as per the circumstances.
Has he said that without bringing down the government, they are going to come back home?
That he has said that, you know, there is no going back, that they have burned their boats.
So it is a sit-in, right?
It will be definitely.
It is a reverse engineering thing, right?
I think there are two things which are in his mind, which is why he is not declaring it to be a sit-in. Firstly and foremostly, there might be a legal challenge to it. Okay. And, you know, if the courts, because we have seen in the past how the Faizabad sit-in, you know, it was not judged in a very positive manner by the courts, and the discomfort, faced by the people of the Twin Cities, you know, it brought life to a standstill, and, you know, people, the ambulances could not pass, and, you know.
Children died.
And then the
person who was actually, responsible for that sit-in was congratulating the daughter who died in the ambulance.
Exactly.
Because he thought that she died for a good cause.
Exactly.
So that also happens in this country, and that is the problem. My concern is, from legal challenge, from the courts, to the executive, to the on-ground realities, somehow everything is lost in translation. We don't see that kind of executive, action to stop people. We don't seem to know how. A, do we have the kind of laws to stop a similar kind of demonstration which might paralyze a city? Secondly, if that happens, do we have the mechanism, executive mechanism, to control that kind of situation?
Well, we saw what happened in the past, you know, even the Tariqe Labbaik, you know, when they came and they managed to block down and lock down Faizabad. And we saw that there was an anti-riot police which came into action, and there was an operation. So the law is there, and practically there was a will
without
of the,
weapons.
Without weapons, yes. But, I mean, the will was there. The state had that will, and the state tried to execute it. But at the end, what happened? It was a failed operation. So by using force, we have seen that these kind of operations against a sit-in, which is over there, you know, it becomes very difficult. And the loss of lives, you know, it might happen that people lose their lives. So what the state is trying to do at this point in time is, they're trying to preempt the very gathering. Even though it is being labeled as a Azadi march, and, you know, by Maulana Saab, as it's a peaceful march and all, but they are saying that no, we are not going to allow it to happen.
So in
Punjab and in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, the government will try and disallow people from moving into the federal capital. But on the other hand, in Sindh, where People's Party has extended a support in the sense that they have said, we are not going to block them, we are going to facilitate them. So I think Maulana will strategically try to move from Sindh towards, you know, rather than moving from Khyber Pakhtunkhwa and being initially bogged down, and initial failure will lead into the, total failure.
Sindh is an interesting case, because on one side, People's Party is supporting Maulana, and Maulana seems to be supporting a candidate of PTI. And that is amazing, actually, because on one side you're trying to bring down a government, and then you're supporting their candidate in Sindh. But having said that, my concern again was prevention is one aspect. But there has to be, Javed Rana Saab, cure as well. If somebody comes and sits, you have to have standing operating procedures. How many sit-ins will it take for the Islamabad administration to find a solution to disperse such crowds that might actually create a serious problem for management of the population?
I think this is the most relevant point, and your concern, the point that you're making is very important. Now, on legally speaking, the right to assembly, it's a freedom of expression, that's there. But at what cost and in what manner? I think some kind of mechanism needs to be developed as per law, as per constitution of Pakistan. Now, there have been in the past, unfortunately, political gatherings. We are not going to get into those details.
Please do. That is okay.
That was unfortunate precedent. And now, similar precedent
is trying to be set again set. That should not happen. Maulana Saab,
since you're talking about precedents being set, the problem is there is an incremental change in that. And that is the problem. First, lawyers movement came to Islamabad, right? There wasn't any violence. Then, Imran Khan Saab, Tahrul Qadri, no violence at that time also. But then TLP came, and we knew that there is going to be violence. Now it seems to be a problem that keeps growing. Tomorrow, who else do you expect? There might be actual Taliban coming, they might be threatening to use violence.
I think Maulana Saab should be given a clear option that if you want a protest, a one-day protest, for 3 hours, for 4 hours, for 5 hours, come in. There is a special place which is meant for all these kind of protests.
Uh-huh.
But if...
That also is an interesting argument. When you ask them to sit on sidelines, right?
That is where I am coming.
And they realize that they have zero nuisance value then. And that's why nobody actually covers them. It happened with TLP. First came, sat in a corner. Nobody noticed. Then it came back to Faizabad. And then it wreaked havoc, right? So we seem to be teaching people wrong lessons here.
Successive governments have taught a wrong lesson, because even if there is a big gathering, hundreds of thousands of people come on a particular venue, and the government does not move on any particular issue. That has been the precedent. So what they try to do, they try to destabilize the government. They try to cause problems for the government so the government could negotiate with them. That has been unfortunate precedent. That precedent seems to be being repeated. Mm-hmm. But I think if the government goes for some sort of blockage, if the government try to preempt that to happen, if the government go for crackdown of JUI activists, I would say without violence, I think that in this particular situation...
How do you crack down without violence?
I mean, I'm saying let me use the word arrest.
What are the coercive options without use of force?
I think what KPK Chief Minister has said, that the district organizers of the JUIs would be arrested.
Okay.
I think it makes sense, because at organization level, this is a likely scenario.
Okay. Remember, there was another aspect that you can blockade, right? There might be a blockade on the roads. If you recall, when PTI was coming to Islamabad, there were similar containers everywhere, right? But they didn't stop PTI. They stopped us, you and I, from coming and going and leaving homes. That becomes a problem.
This is going to become the problem again on the same day.
Okay.
The point that I made earlier on the same day, people are going to be maybe in hundreds of thousands who are going elsewhere. They could be mistakenly treated as the activists of the JUI. So I think the government, to begin with, needs to negotiate at least to the point that this date issue is settled on. Mm-hmm. And the second, I think if the Maulana Saab does not agree, if he does not give guarantees to the government that he would not prolong his sit-in,
okay,
then I think the government probably would be right to stop them.
Are you going to Tablighi Jamaat Sejtama?
I never went there.
Okay, twice you have brought it up.
I
was worried that you're more worried about them than me or yourself.
The reason is because it is...
No, I get it.
The common people are going to be affected.
And you and I are common people as well, right? So pray, also focus on us.
The last point I want to make is, Maulana Saab can take a fake credit, mm-hmm, that so many people have come out in his favor,
okay,
which I don't think is going to be the case.
Okay, that is quite interesting.
I think one point which he has raised about the Tablighi Jamaat is right, but I have seen those people, because I used to live in Lahore and I've seen these Tablighi people. They're very naive people. They just come for the prayers to drive.
Nice
in.
People.
Naive and nice.
No, not naive. Never call a believer in
and they just, yes, go there for the religious matter and they just go back. They don't create any fuss. Their cures, they have managed all the things very nicely. But it can be intermingled with this dharna and these jalsas of Fazlur Rahman as well. But I don't understand why Maulana Fazlur Rahman is going for this sit-up and these jalsas. He's even not a parliamentarian. He lost elections.
That's why he might be actually sitting outside the parliament, rather than inside. In my opinion,
it's something else. It's some different agenda, because at this very moment, government of Pakistan and whole of the Pakistan, they are fighting for the rights of Kashmiris.
Okay.
The Kashmir matter is on the board at the moment, and you have seen that Prime Minister Imran Khan has said that he is the ambassador of Kashmir. He is going all over the world. They are talking to the diplomats for Kashmir to lift the curfew in Kashmir and to pressurize Modi to stop atrocities and brutalities in Kashmir. So just to stop these things or to turn the table around, and Maulana Sahib is on some another agenda, so he can divert the attention of the people.
Okay, so he is serving some foreigners.
I think so. He is serving somebody else
because how would you accuse him of that? Because he was the head of Kashmir
committee.
Because
at this stage, he is diverting the attention of the international media, international people. When Pakistan is fighting for the rights of Kashmiris, when Prime Minister is going all the way for the peace in the region, and then how can he come here and can divert the attention? And
may I submit one thing?
Not appropriate.
I totally disagree with whatever Maulana has done or does, right? But I don't believe in McCarthyism, because you have to have some kind of evidence to actually claim that somebody is serving the enemies of the country.
It looks like, I'm not blaming that he is serving, definitely.
Okay, you thought.
It looks like.
It gives you the
impression. In my opinion, because this is not the right time.
Okay.
Because whole of the nation is fighting for the rights of Kashmiris.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the main agenda at the moment. And
He might have his own strange way to fight for Kashmiris. I don't know whether
he will not serve the people of Islamabad by coming here.
That is the bigger point.
Making chaos over here.
Yeah.
At the moment, the economic conditions of Pakistan are not that good. We are facing the grey list in FATF as well. So
okay.
At the moment, we need to rise as a nation. We need to bring things in a positive manner.
Right. Let me ask another question, Barrister Saab. Let us try to focus on the legal aspects. Is it okay in Pakistan's constitution, according to Pakistan's constitution, to actually have militias, armed militias of your own? In America's constitution, you are allowed to have them, right? Is it? Do we also have that kind of permission in our constitution?
Well, we do have the right to own a gun or an arms. You know, we have laws for that.
Armed militias.
No, I'm coming to that.
Yeah.
When we talk about armed militias, you know, that is a totally different chapter and a totally different perspective, because then you're not talking about self-defense.
Right.
Then you're not talking about, you know, then it becomes an uprising or a guerrilla movement of some sort, or, you know, in that kind of category.
Right.
So after the National Action Plan, which came into Pakistan, and, you know, post APS attack and post all these measures that we took against all these kind of groups who were operating, you know, with or without foreign support, you know, in Balochistan, in elsewhere, in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, in Punjab, we outlawed them.
Okay.
And we placed the list of all these kind of organizations in our own, you know, list, and we banned them from taking part in our political activities or in other activities also.
Right. Now,
and
let me,
now,
I want to actually build an argument here. Again, the definition of armed would include only weapons like guns, or anybody who is willing to beat anybody using sticks, stones, whatever. Will that also come into the definition of armed?
Not arms necessarily, but definitely a weapon. I mean,
Not armed.
Yes, armed.
Armed militias.
Armed. Yes, you can say they are armed, but
For example, RSS.
Yeah.
India's RSS uses sticks to beat people, right? And they carry those staffs all around. So that will be called an armed militia or not?
Well, it depends. I mean, because, you know, the stick has various uses. I mean, if we are talking about the Tablighi Jamaat, and, you know, if you notice, if you go to one of the congregations, they do have, you know, the sticks, and they have those sticks because of, you know, they want
support
to
system.
Support, okay. And they want to protect their members, and they want to also, like,
There is a reason why I'm asking you this. Videos came yesterday and day before yesterday. Maulana actually taking, you know, a guard of honor from his own students who were clad in saffron, I guess.
Scouts.
Huh? Like scouts, but it was saffronish color. And they were carrying, you know, staffs. And they seemed to be armed. They had uniforms. So will you call it an armed militia?
Well, if you see the timing of it, you know, with this Azadi March coming up, had it been at some other point in time, you know, had it been like, for instance, celebration of the 40 of the Independence Day, you know, or something like that of that sort. It wouldn't have been as, you know, apprehensible that those images, you know, being showed live across all the news channels and also being shared on the mobiles. Mm-hmm. But this does give an impression that coming October 31st, when he has announced a march and he has announced that he is coming all guns blazing, that this might turn into some kind of a violent movement.
Right. So the government of Pakistan and the government of Khyber Pakhtunkhwa and other provinces will be within their rights to take whatever measures necessary to avert such a catastrophe? Then?
Well, if Maulana fails to assure them, if he fails to assure the government of Pakistan or the courts, wherever you know this matter is being petitioned or being challenged, then definitely they will say that they have this right to protect the citizens, and this is what they're saying even now.
Okay.
But I think that for that even for that step to be taken, I think still a lot of ground has to be covered.
Right.
They have entered into that dialogue mode as of yesterday. The Chief Minister of Punjab, you know, he visited the residence of Chori Shujaat Hussain, mm-hmm. and Chori Shujaat Hussain has very cordial and good ties with the Maulana. So I mean, they're trying to engage with him. So I hope so that that step would not come. I mean, because if that step were to come, we don't know how that might you know, pan out in the future.
Right. That is quite an interesting aspect, and we are going to talk about a potential blowback as well of any action. But Javed Rana Sahab, now let us focus on A, we have looked at the government, we have looked at what Maulana is doing and what are the options. Now, let us focus on PMLN. There seems to be a sasbout drama going on there, right? It seems that the elder brother and the younger brother and the elder brother's daughter are of two minds, and then there is kind of contradiction and undermining of each other. Is it true?
Well, those who want to support Maulana's march, I mean, former Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif and his daughter Mariam Nawaz, they cannot organize anything.
Okay.
So they have a desire to support Maulana's march. And Nawaz Sharif, during his brief talk with the media when he was out for an appearance in the court, I think he made a general public appeal to his supporters.
Who did?
Nawaz Sharif.
Nawaz Sharif wrote a letter to Maulana.
But apart from that,
and he was so worried that his own brother might not convey that he used another external emissary as well to ensure that it reaches
Maulana. And also through media, he conveyed that message that he is supporting it.
Okay.
Now the point is that those who are supposed to organize this march on the behalf of PMLN, that is Shehbaz Sharif,
okay,
who doesn't want to support.
So who controls the workers of PMLN right now?
Nawaz Sharif certainly has an influence.
Okay.
So workers would go on their own.
Mm-hmm.
But again, it would be a half-hearted effort.
Okay. Because he seems to be averse to the idea of joining this march, is he not?
He is for very obvious reasons. Mm-hmm. He doesn't want to take the situation to a point where government feels more resentful against the PMLN.
Okay.
And more particularly about this.
Is it really worried about the government?
I'm talking, the second word I'm going to use was about the establishment also.
Okay.
So I think in that,
Maulana Fazlur Rahman is not marching on establishment. He's marching on the federal capital.
But this is the unique kind of a march which doesn't have a support from quarters within the establishment.
Okay, the quarters you keep on seeing and I refuse to
see. I say there is no support. There's no support.
Yeah.
So he doesn't have a support from those quarters who matter. He doesn't have a support from the large general public. His support base are the poor, brainwashed, indoctrinated children of madrasas,
okay,
who've been told certain things that Islam is in danger.
Why did you use this kind of loaded language, right?
I use it.
Brainwashed. I mean, how will you qualify that?
The reason I'm saying is, the Maulana Sahab is not telling
you
them.
You could have said his blind followers.
Maulana Sahab is not telling them the facts.
Okay.
What particular issue is there where government has defied certain Islamic laws?
Okay, he's using a religious argument.
He's using a religious card. He's quoting past incidents,
mm-hmm,
of Asia Bibi's release, mm-hmm,
He is quoting one member of the Qadiani who was allowed to leave Pakistan despite the fact that he was convicted. Yeah. But the point is, he should have had a march 6 months back, a year ago.
Two examples are enough to bring down a government.
But the point is, there has to be certain morality.
Okay, this officially saddens me that this is the argument.
These are the two things which have happened during last 1.5 years, mm-hmm. and Maulana Saab is trying to politically propagate against the government on these issues.
Right.
And very interestingly, when the certain laws were changed, election laws were changed, it was seen to favor certain non-Muslim group. Mm. When during Nawaz Sharif's government. Maulana Saab was sitting with the then Prime Minister.
Yeah,
he had no problems.
Yeah.
And now then he was.
This is the entirety of Maulana's argument.
You know, the
he's not using the inflation card. He's not using the election.
I think Maulana Saab doesn't have the understanding of the economy, frankly.
Okay.
And he taught.
Why will you say that?
The reason I'm saying this.
He's a rich man, is he not?
He has served Kashmir Committee for decades,
okay.
And he didn't know that on 27th of October, Kashmir was occupied.
But that is not economics.
But that's I'm telling you about an issue which he was handling for decades.
Okay.
On economy, I think his understanding is a sort of superficial.
Okay.
He doesn't have an in-depth understanding. When we talk of economy, mm-hmm. then I think the politician must know the hard realities,
okay.
on the ground.
Right.
And the point that you are making is extremely important.
Mm-hmm.
Maulana Saab should agitate over price hike.
Wait, this is not my point. I don't want any agitation.
I am saying that
there was a legitimate argument
legitimate argument.
When even the government sees.
And he will talk about economy, about inflation and price hike in the media. But that is not argument he's giving to the madrasa children.
Right.
That is at the core of the problem.
And not even transparency of the elections, right? He keeps on talking about and things if there was
a problem with election riggings,
right.
That I think right in the beginning, he should not have sent his son to the parliament.
Okay, I think Barrister Saab wants to add here. Then Siddiqui Saab, I'm coming to you. Please go ahead.
I think we're being a bit unfair on the Maulana. I mean, having
I'm trying to actually balance it out.
Well, if you look at this protest that he has announced, you know, on the October 31st, it is not the result of a religious event that happened. You know, what provoked Tehreek e Labbaik ya Rasulullah, for instance,
mm-hmm.
you know, it was not, it was the result of some blasphemy laws being changed or amended or whatever.
Actually, TLP's creation was a result of one hanging.
Yes.
Hanging of Mumtaz Qadri.
And that was an incident.
But the election law was also
That was
changed.
Part of a series of events which led to this, you know, event happening. What I'm trying to say over here is that all the opposition parties, you know, they were for quite some time, they were deliberating on this issue that given how the country's economy is heading towards, you know,
right.
in a very downward spiral and going out of control,
mm-hmm.
how are we going to connect with the people and how do we, protest against the government?
Okay.
This issue was brewing even before Ramadan. If you remember,
yeah.
And then they decided, okay, let Ramadan pass. It is not the right time to stage any kind of a movement. And after Eid, we will decide.
Then Muharram. You are talking about which party?
I am talking about the opposition,
right?
The People's Party, PMLN, and Maulana.
When you talk about inflation, when you talk about economic conditions, which might be on the mend, but they are difficult, right? We haven't seen a single public speech coming from the opposition, which actually deconstructs the government's, entire operation or government's way of functioning, and then talk about agitating, right? We have heard about elections not being transparent, as was claimed by Maulana and others, but that momentum was lost also. Now the question is whether we are being fair or not. You can take any supporter of Maulana on it. Either they won't know why Maulana is coming to Islamabad, right? Or they would say Islam is in jeopardy. So it is essentially a religious argument, is it?
Well, I think that this is the first movement, a political movement by a religious party which is not of a religious nature. The movement or the argument that they're taking is not purely religious. Yes, I agree that they do say that the government is heading in the wrong direction. They are, they do, whenever they're delivering speeches, they do refer to the Asia Bibi case. Yes, they do also refer.
Maulana Fazlur Rahman, when he first actually collected the funds to actually, bring the procession to Islamabad, it was the certificates or the receipts were given. It was first called Namus-e-Risalat Rally. It is a religious argument. I mean, I'm not being unfair. Nobody is.
I don't know that what he said or what he did not said. I am just talking about the media news and the media briefings that he has been giving and the media talks that he has been giving. Okay. He talks about unfair elections. And in that respect, I'm talking about that this is the first, because whenever we saw previously in the 1990s, when the Dharna politics were being, Jamaat-e-Islami was there and they were out on the street, at that point in time, they were going against that particular government based upon that elections or, whatever that card was. Okay. After that, they came into power.
No, but you're forgetting his own father who brought down Bhutto's government, right, Mufti Mahmood. And he was using a political platform, a PNA, that was not essentially religious, although he was a religious man and his party was a religious party. But let me come back to PMLN's politics, Naseem Siddiqui Sahab, because it seems to me that other political parties might have nuisance value when it comes to staging or blocking a city. But if you talk about electoral support, there are three parties in this order which might actually have that kind of support: PTI, PMLN, and People's Party. People's Party might be limited to Sindh, PMLN to the GT Road, and rest of the places we have seen support coming out for PTI. Now, the problem is, second largest party in the parliament doesn't know who's the leader. So who's going to support Maulana then?
Yeah, definitely PMLN is in doldrums at the moment, both the Nawaz Sharif family and the Shahbaz Sharif family. Mm-hmm. Because the main leader, Nawaz Sharif, is in jail as well, whereas Maryam Nawaz, who can gather the workers or he can make a crowd of those workers. And then Shahbaz Sharif, he's facing the same problem. Hamza Shahbaz Sharif is in jail and the other, his son Salman, is out of the country.
Yeah, so but it doesn't change who they are.
Yeah, but
Maryam is going to provoke. She wants to fight.
But there is nobody to provoke the workers at the moment. Who will bring out the workers from their domains or from their constituency? Nobody is ready at the moment. And PMLN don't have any street power. They haven't shown any street power in past as well. When Nawaz Sharif came from London,
That was a different situation.
But the People's Party workers...
Shahbaz Sharif, his own brother, couldn't actually make it to deceive him. Right? That was a very different kind of situation.
I was talking about when Musharraf government was there and Nawaz Sharif make an attempt to come to Pakistan, then there was no workers outside. You have seen that whatever is the conditions, People's Party workers are everywhere. You have seen that when Bilawal came to NAP court, there was lot many workers over there to support him.
Few hundreds. Yeah.
But it was a big out of control mob.
It was a big support. We haven't seen anything outside the NAP court when Nawaz Sharif used to come over there.
Right.
So they don't have that much support, or People's Party is also not willing to support, because I've seen Bilawal, he's saying that he will not be part of that sit out. He's against that one. And whereas, because Zardari Saab is inside and he want to come whatsoever, so he is supporting Maulana.
I had a couple of more questions, but I hope in coming days we are going to see concert. We have to conclude the program. Please go ahead quickly.
To be fair to PMLN, there was a long march which Nawaz Sharif led when he was going for the restoration of judges. Mm-hmm. And it was that street power which in the end, it forced People's Party to restore those judges.
It was PMLN supporters or lawyers?
Both.
Because
both,
in that car, I remember I covered it. I'm a journalist, right? I covered it and I remember there were two people sitting in that that vehicle. One was Mian Nawaz Sharif, the other was Ittezaz Ehsan. And he was actually the leader of lawyers' movement.
It is true that the driving force was the lawyers' movement, but obviously when a decisive political force decides to join a mass movement...
We keep on talking about past. because every year things change, people change.
But my point was that the reason why they don't have the street power, as you can see right now, is because the leadership is in jail.
Yeah, twice you have said that let us be fair to them, right? We try to be as fair as possible. It is my habit to try to be as fair as possible, but of course we are mortals. We have our own limitations. We do try, though. On that, we have to conclude the program. Barrister Danish Iftikhar, thank you very much for being part of the program. Naseem Siddiqui Saab, thank you very much for your participation, as well as Javed Rana Saab, thank you very much for being here. Viewers, you have listened to our participants. This discussion has to continue because Maulana is going to come. And then you have to actually find a solution to it as well. But this constant state of anarchy where somebody keeps on challenging some incumbents, and we have been seeing it since the lawyers' movement, I mean, it kind of gives a negative, it has a negative impact on people's minds and hearts, and especially the citizens or residents of Islamabad, because it seems to be happening a lot. Let us hope in coming days we find at least some kind of mechanism to take care of people who might actually stage a sit-in here. This was today's program. Thank you very much for watching us. Take care.